Good morning, everyone. We're going to start by singing I Heard the Voice of Jesus Say, Voices United 626. Please be seated. Can you hear me? Good morning. I'm Stacy Mortson. I'm still a student minister here for a few weeks longer at Trinity Centennial United Church in Rosemont. Welcome to worship, whether you are joining us here this morning in the sanctuary or watching from home later today. In person or in cyberspace, you are a part of this beloved community. So two announcements before we get started. One is Tracy and Chris are going to be putting on a Jigs dinner. There's a sign-up sheet in the narthex, or you can talk to Tracy about that. And secondly, you have all heard, I'm sure, that Marion Eby has passed away, and her visitation and funeral will both be held Tuesday morning at Thomas's, 10 o'clock for a visitation and 11 o'clock for the funeral there, and there'll be a reception following. Anything else I'm missing? Today is the fourth Sunday in the season of Lent, and today we're going to hear about two different women from different continents and different cultures, both of whom reveal something of the sacredness of living water and who seek justice on behalf of marginalized people. The gospel lesson is about a woman who meets Jesus, and together they have the longest recorded conversation that Jesus has with anyone in the gospels. It's a favorite of mine, and I had the opportunity to read this scripture on the site of Jacob's Well. And every time I read it, I learn more. And we'll be presenting it in a rather unorthodox manner. Stay tuned. Now take a deep breath. Inhale and exhale, and prepare to meet the Holy One in this time of worship. And we'll do our tenebrae together. Though we thirst for great vision, many of our visions are limited. Yet we do not know just how limited we are spiritually. We do not know that we do not know. Content to live with illusions and self-delusions, the people of this world do not even want to know this and truth. As the prophet Joel said, when the leaders lack vision, it is the people who suffer. We suffer from narrow leadership, compromised integrity, and self-centered values. We experience the suffering of God's people on our streets. Great thirst abounds in shantytowns, in refugee camps, and in every neighborhood. Let's pray together. O God, we long for enlightened leaders to emerge who have the audacity to hope and to declare the truth we long to receive. How long must we wait for living waters? How long must we suffer? Or are we the ones who are to lower our buckets to find new possibilities? Then open our spirits for us to embrace your truth. Open our minds to receive your wisdom. Open our hearts like leather vessels to love widely, generously, and deeply. May we pull our faith from deep wells, and may we experience your kingdom on earth as it is in heaven. Amen. And we'll say our territorial acknowledgement together. We acknowledge this sanctuary is located on the treaty lands and traditional territory of the Anishinaabe peoples, including the Odawa, the Ojibwa, and the Potawatomi nations, known together as the Three Fires Confederacy. Rosemont is covered by the Lake Simcoe Nottawasaga Treaty Number 18, signed in 1818. With the Chippewa Nation. This area is now home to many diverse First Nations, Inuit, and Métis peoples. We acknowledge that we are all treaty people, settler and Indigenous alike, and accept our responsibility to honor all our relations while praying that we may move forward in the spirit of relationship, reconciliation, and respect for all. As we gather for worship, we'll say our call to worship responsively. We gather as God's beloved children. However glad we are, however out of sorts we are, we come together as a people whom Jesus calls into community. So this becomes a well where all are welcome. We have come to give thanks, to pray, and to sing, and to be with others. Let us worship God. And we'll do our gathering prayer responsively as well. You've got a big role to play today. Life-giving God, another week is done, and we have arrived here again as weary travelers. We are thirsty, O God. Please give us something to drink. Still speaking, God. Our lips are parched and our bellies ache. We have not had enough to satisfy us. We are thirsty, O God. Please give us something to drink. We come with no buckets or jars, but with open, cupped hands, dreaming of your soothing gift. We are thirsty, O God. Give us something to drink. You have promised us something new, something that will feed our bodies and our souls. Something to satisfy. We are thirsty, O God. Please give us something to drink. Amen. As you might have guessed, we're talking about water today and wells and slaking our thirst. And so we'll sing Voices United, number 449, Crashing Waters at Creation. You may be seated. And as is our custom during Lent, we say a prayer of confession. Let's do that together. God of living waters, we confess that we have often turned from you and wandered in our own wilderness of fear and doubt. Our thirst mounts daily, seeking to be quenched by your redeeming love. Yet, when that love is offered to us, we again turn away, unable to truly believe that you would actually heal and love us. We have behaved in very unloving ways. We have chosen to ignore those in need or to deal only passively with them. Our hearts are not placed in service to others, but rather in self-serving motives. Help us, merciful God, wash us again in the living water. Help us be faithful servants. Amen. My friends, the waters of mercy and healing are poured over you. God is loving and faithful to those who come to God. Come, seek the loving presence and be healed. Amen. And we have a storybook today. It's called We Are Water People, Water Protectors. Water is the first medicine, no chemist told me. We come from water. It nourished us inside our mother's body, and it nourishes us here on Mother Earth. Water is sacred, she said. We stand with our songs and our drums. We are still here. The river's rhythm runs through my veins, runs through my people's veins. My people talk of a black snake that will destroy the land, spoil the water, poison plants and animals, wreck everything in its path. When my people first spoke of the black snake, they foretold that it wouldn't come for many, many years. Now, the black snake is here. Its venom burns the land, courses through the water, making it unfit to drink. Okay? Take courage. I must keep the black snake away from my village's water. I must rally my people together to stand for the water, to stand for the land, to stand as one against the black snake. We stand with our songs and our drums. We are still here. It will not be easy. We will fight for those who cannot fight for themselves, the winged ones, the crawling ones, the four-legged, the two-legged, the plants, trees, rivers, and lakes. We are all related. Tears like waterfalls stream down, tracks down my face, tracks down my people's faces. Water has its own spirit, no chemist told me. Water is alive. Water remembers our ancestors who came before us, she said. We stand with our songs and our dreams. We are still here. We are stewards of the earth. Our spirits have not been broken. We are water protectors. We stand. The end. You're going to find that that story ties very closely with the gospel today. So while we are singing, listen, listen, God is calling, I'm going to invite Evan, Megan, forward during the song. we'll also have Lois as the narrator. As today's scripture is so very long, I thought we'd experiment with a different method of delivery. Not only will we hear the conversation between Jesus and the Samaritan woman, we'll do sort of a freeze frame between the major themes for a teaching moment on what is happening at that time. Kenneth Bailey, a theologian who lived in the Middle East for about 40 years, writes in his book, Jesus Through Middle Eastern Eyes, about the 10 surprises in this pericope. Evan, Megan, and Lois will help tell the story. Go ahead, Lois.
Introduction. He left Judea and started back to Galilee, but he had to go through Samaria. So he came to a Samaritan city called Sychar, near the plot of ground, plot where Jacob had given his son to Joseph. Jacob's well was there, and Jesus, tired out by his journey, was sitting by the well. It was about noon.
So when we read scripture as 21st century North Americans, we often miss many nuances that would be obvious to the people of that time and place. Each word and phrase is carefully chosen and placed to convey meaning. And we need to look at the context of where the stories are placed in the whole narrative. In this case, Jesus is leaving Judea to avoid dissension between his disciples and John's and returning to Galilee. Yes, the lads have been duking it out. But Jesus takes the higher road and withdraws to home territory. Instead of taking the more easterly route over to the Dead Sea and then up north, and the track any self-respecting Jew would take to avoid contamination or assault by those nasty Samaritans, Jesus chooses the dangerous and unexpected path. He takes a shortcut through enemy lands. Why do you think he did that? I've actually driven that road, which is now a beautiful paved highway in Palestinian territory. I was in an air-conditioned coach with a cooler of cold water. From Jerusalem to Sychar was about 45 minutes or so by bus, a route that Jesus walked in probably about 6 hours. The area is arid, barren, rocky, and hilly, with very few trees for shade. And Jesus arrived at the hottest time of the day. No wonder he sat down at the well. He must have been parched. Jesus is fully divine, but Jesus is also fully human. Further, he arrives in broad daylight, which is a huge contrast to the nighttime clandestine meeting he had had with Nicodemus in the previous chapter. A virtuous religious man, Nicodemus was ashamed to be seen with Jesus. But as we will see, the woman of Sychar felt differently. There are many surprises to be found in this engagement.
Surprise number one, intentional self-emptying.
Oh, microphone.
Oh, sorry. Shall I start again?
Yeah.
Surprise number one, intentional self-emptying. Jesus sat alone on the well because his disciples had gone to the city to buy food.
Give me a drink.
How is it that you, a Jew, ask a drink of me, a woman of Samaria?
For Jews did not use vessels in common with Samaritans.
Because Middle Eastern village women avoid the heat of the day by carrying water early in the morning, and for propriety's sake always travel in a group, it is unusual for a woman to be at the well alone. Because of this, she has been labeled as an outcast. And that may be so, but perhaps maybe she just enjoys solitude, or maybe she's hoping to make contact with travelers who would be there in the middle of the day and engage in conversation. As we'll see, she's quite able to converse with intelligence. When I drank from Jacob's well, there was a galvanized bucket available. But in Jesus' time, each visitor to the well would have their own leather bucket, which they would lower down into the well to dip the water. And then the women would fill large jars, such as this one, and carry them on their head. Jesus' band of followers would have had a leather bucket rolled up in their supplies, but they've inadvertently gone to town with it. And Jesus could have requested it before they left, but he had a plan. He deliberately places his thirsty self at the mercy of the woman with the means to slake his thirst. Well, so what, you might ask? Jesus is breaking all kinds of taboos by doing that. Socially and culturally, even today in villages in the Middle East, a man would not make eye contact with a woman, but withdraw to a safe distance. Here, Jesus is remaining in her company and talking to her, ignoring the 500-year hostility that had developed between Jews and Samaritans. What does that tell you about the character of God? Yet also contained in this drama is a profound theology of mission. Jesus humbles himself with his need for her services. He does not establish his relationship by telling her how much she needs him and she needs his message. That comes later. But think of that in terms of how Westerners have gone about evangelizing in foreign lands. Jesus understands the necessity of being a receiver. When he sends the disciples out, they are to take nothing for their journey except a staff, no bag, no water, just sandals and a cloak, to put themselves in need of hospitality among the folks they are to teach. And here, Jesus' self-emptying was so total, he needed to be served. He got his ego out of the way so that God's will could be done. That's kenosis, self-emptying, kenosis. By doing this, Jesus elevates the woman's self-worth. Her dignity is affirmed. She is lifted from a place of powerlessness as a woman and as a Samaritan. She no longer feels defiled. This is amazing grace. Lois?
Surprise number two, God's gift is a person.
If you knew the gift of God and who it is that is saying to you, give me a drink, you would have asked him, and he would have given you living water.
Sir, you have no bucket, and the well is deep. Where do you get that living water? Are you greater than our ancestor Jacob, who gave us the well with his sons, and his flocks drank from it?
Wow, these verses are really loaded. The Samaritans would have viewed the gift of God as literally the Torah of Moses, and the Jews would have added the books of the prophets. They believed God's gift was a book. But Isaiah was told by God, I have given you as a covenant to the people, a light to the nations. The covenant is not a book, but a person. And this woman meets this gift of God at the community well. Jeremiah had referred to God as living water centuries before, and now this language is applied to Jesus. The woman expresses some doubt yet, though. She wonders how he can give her water, knowing how very deep that well is. And the well is literally so very deep. I remember how long it took before I could hear a splash as the bucket lowered into the waters below, and how long it took to wind it back up. And oh, the wait was worth it. Clear and cold, it quenched my throat, and I was awed that I could drink from the same well Jesus had 2,000 years before, and Jacob another 1,500 years before that. But the depth of the well could also refer to the depths of her own soul and her longing for God. Her comment about Jacob could also be taken in two ways. She might be commenting to Jesus about their common ancestor, Jacob, or she could be claiming Jacob as the Samaritan ancestor. It was a bone of contention between the two peoples. So without hearing her actual tone, we might never know what she meant.
Surprise number three, the drink that conquers time.
Oh. Everyone who drinks of this water will be thirsty again. But those who drink of the water that I will give them will never be thirsty. The water that I will give will become in them a spring of water gushing up to eternal life.
Sir, give me this water so that I may never be thirsty or have to keep coming here to draw water.
Notice how Jesus just tactfully avoids her political challenge about Jacob. He just refuses to discuss who can claim Jacob as their ancestor or who owns the well. So he skips over the superficial and he dives right into the water itself and offers her a drink that permanently conquers thirst and becomes a spring for others, overflowing to eternity. But she only hears the first part. She's glad to have that magical drink that will lighten her daily grind. Religion that will ease her pain, make her feel good, lift her depression, make her feel safe. But she's not interested in becoming that spring for others, at least not yet.
Surprise number four, a spring for others.
Go, call your husband and come back.
I have no husband.
This might turn into an interesting lunchtime conversation between Megan and Evan. Jesus says those three little words, go, call, bring. It sounds simple, but it requires that she, a woman, become a witness to a man. In her world, that was not possible, but Jesus assumes it is and challenges her to believe that with God, a woman's witness can be judged reliable. The next time Jesus utters those same words in John's Gospel, it is to Mary Magdalene at the tomb. You, woman, go and tell the men. The woman is given a whole new understanding of herself and a whole new vision of God, a vision of inclusivity and of respect for each of God's children. It's actually pretty mind-boggling. So how can she respond? She deflects when she says, I have no husband. Surprise number five.
Surprise number five, an escape into religion.
You are right in saying, I have no husband, for you have had five husbands, and the one you have now is not your husband. What you have said is true.
Sir, I see that you are a prophet. Our ancestors worshipped on this mountain, but you say that the place where people must worship is in Jerusalem.
Uh-oh, she's busted. Technically, she was telling the truth, but not the whole truth. The water of life was flowing over her, and like the water of a stream that exposes the roots of a tree, her roots are exposed. Misogynistic theology over the centuries has vilified this woman with the scandal of five husbands. But really, that was not her decision. She'd probably have been married off at age 12 to an old man who probably died. And if she hadn't borne him a son, she'd have been passed on to his brother and perhaps his brother and another brother after that. Almost certainly, she was a victim rather than a tramp, as we've been led to believe. In any case, embarrassed by this exposure, she deflects. She becomes a theologian, desperately trying to change the topic, and engages Jesus on the divide between their two peoples. And Jesus doesn't scold her for the diversion, but uses her question to move the old debate to a new and more profound level. He's okay to challenge what's been happening. What does this tell us about the character of God?
Surprise number six, debunking tradition.
Woman, believe me, the hour is coming when you will worship the Father, neither on this mountain nor in Jerusalem. You worship what you do not know. We worship what we know, for salvation is from the Jews. But the hour is coming, and is now here, when the true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and truth, for the Father seeks such as these to worship him. God is spirit, and those who worship him must worship in spirit and truth.
I know that Messiah is coming, who is called Christ. When he comes, he will proclaim all things to us.
Oh man, I love that Jesus treats this woman as a serious theologian, elevating her, and in the process, all women with her. He reveals to her the most important teaching on worship in the entire New Testament. The question is, where is the divine presence of God to be found? On this mountain or that mountain? Well, Jesus answers that both of those answers are obsolete. Jesus de-Zionizes. That was the quiz, remember? What is Zion? Zion is the hill on which the temple in Jerusalem is built. So Jesus debunks the tradition and chooses this simple woman as the recipient of this amazing news. Both Jews and Samaritans, indeed all the world, will be summoned into true worship. It doesn't matter where. God is not on this mountain or that mountain. God is not essence, but God is action. God's being is action. The woman's response appears to be a huge sigh, along with the hope that, maybe one day the Messiah will come and clarify all these complicated questions.
Surprise number 7, the first I am.
I that am talking to you, I am.
Another short but spectacular statement rocks her world. Remember Moses, way back at the burning bush? He asked who was speaking to him, and the voice from the bush simply said, I am. Amazingly, Jesus opens a whole series of revelatory statements with this nameless woman. John records several similar proclamations by Jesus in the following chapters. I am the bread of life. I am the light of the world. I am the door. I am the good shepherd. I am the true and living way. I am the vine. What does this tell us of the character of God revealed in this Jesus?
Surprise number 8, the first Christian female preacher. Just then his disciples came. They were astonished that he was speaking with a woman, but no one said, "What do you want?" or "Why are you speaking to her?" Then the woman left her water jar and went back to the city. She said to the people,
"Come and see a man who told me everything I have ever done. He cannot be the Messiah, can he?"
They left the city and were on their way to him.
So the disciples appear on the scene and they're stunned. A self-respecting rabbi did not even talk to his own wife in a public place. Why is their master engaged in a conversation with this Samaritan woman, of all things? No one dared to ask him, "What do you want?" which is an idiom for, "Do you want us to get rid of her for you?" Think Tony Soprano. "What do you want us to do here?" And neither do they scold him. "Why are you shaming yourself with this?" They fell silent. I imagine the air is heavy with rejection, and sensing hostility in their silence, she runs away. But she departs, not only to carry out Jesus' command to go call your husband and come, she expands her own mandate and witnesses to the entire community. In her excitement, she leaves her jar behind. Now that's an actual eyewitness recollection. But John had a reason to include this observation. Is it to recognize that she was just frenzied with excitement? Or maybe it's an allegory for leaving her former life behind. She came to draw water that will quench thirst for 1 hour. She returns to the village without water. Instead, she carries witness to the water that quenches the thirst of the spirit forever. She did become that spring for others, as Jesus had earlier suggested. Still, not confident that the townsfolk will believe her testimony, she invites them to come and find out for themselves if this might be the Christ.
Surprise number 9, invisible food. Meanwhile, the disciples were urging him, "Rabbi, eat something."
"I have food to eat that you do not know about."
So the disciples said to one another, "Surely no one has brought him something to eat."
"My food is to do the will of him who sent me and to complete his work. Do you not say 4 months more, then comes the harvest? But I tell you, look around you and see how the fields are ripe for harvesting. The reaper is already receiving wages and is gathering fruit for eternal life, so that sower and reaper may rejoice together. For here, the saying holds true, one sows and another reaps. I sent you to reap that for which you did not labor. Others have labored, and you have entered into their labor."
The woman who came seeking well water carries divine living water back to the village. The disciples return bringing human food from the village to find Jesus has been renewed by divine food, something they don't quite understand. It is the sustaining nourishment received when one is engaged in fulfilling the will of God, sharing the good news. Two kinds of drink, two kinds of food. One is passing, one is eternally sustaining. Something to ponder. And Jesus has been sowing, and the harvest is visible already. She's on the road from the village. Chronos time, measured time between planting and plucking, has collapsed. Things are happening in Kairos time, God's time, in the fullness of time.
Surprise number 10, the true Savior. Many Samaritans from that city believed in him because of the woman's testimony.
"He told me everything I have ever done."
So when the Samaritans came to him, they asked him to stay with them, and he stayed for 2 days. And many more believed because of his word. They said to the woman, "It is no longer because of what you said that we believe, for we have heard for ourselves, and we know that this is truly the Savior of the world."
Well, of course Jesus is truly the Savior of the world, right? We know that. That's the only Savior we have ever known. But for centuries, Greek and Roman rulers were given the title of Savior. And many pagan gods and demigods held the title Savior of the world. Caesar Augustus had died just 15 years before Jesus visited Samaria, and his temple was really quite close to Jacob's well. Naturally, the Samaritans did not share the Roman oppressors' views, but they would have been familiar with the calling of Caesar, the Savior of the world. So after 2 days of intense discussion with Jesus, the Samaritans can be seen affirming the alternative. Jesus is the true Savior of the world. The great Eastern Father, Ephrem the Syrian from the 4th century, wrote, "At the beginning of the conversation, Jesus did not make himself known to her. But first she caught sight of a thirsty man, then a Jew, then a rabbi, afterwards a prophet, and last of all, she saw the Messiah. She tried to get the better of the thirsty man. She showed dislike of the Jew. She heckled the rabbi. Then she was swept off her feet by the prophet, and she adored the Christ." There is so much to be learned about the character of Jesus and of God and of the Holy Spirit in this piece. Sometimes we go away from the scriptures with even more questions than we brought to it. And that's okay. It's in the asking and the discerning that we grow and learn. Now, I hope you know more about God, but also know God a little more deeply from this morning's contemplations. And thank you to our thespians for making the scripture come alive for us in new ways. Well done. Amen. So you can be seated. And might want to turn off your microphone unless you want to be on TV singing. So Mary will sing number 117 for more voices, but to a different tune that we'll all know a little better. By the well, a thirsty woman. You may be seated. We are called to drink of the living waters and to share the hope of newness of life in Christ with the world. Let us offer thanks to God for all God has given us by generously sharing of ourselves and of our resources. Through our gifts, may all experience the hope to be found in our life-giving God. Our offerings will now be received. Let's pray together. Life-giving God, We offer you ourselves and our resources. Use us and our gifts that we may be water bearers to a world thirsty for love, for meaning, for justice, and for hope. May all your people encounter fullness of life through the love of Christ, which lives within us. Amen. Please be seated. As we begin our prayers, let's start with, Lord, listen to your children. O God, meet us at the wells where we are lonely, where we are forgotten, where we are hurt by others, and give us to drink of the grace that brings life again. O God, speak to us in the trysting places where the sinners gather, where the prejudices are made known, where our histories are broadcast. And give us to drink of the forgiveness that brings peace again. O God, renew all that we are and have been. Fill us with a new future. Inspire us with recreation. Pull us into resurrection. And give us to drink from the promise of heaven. There is so much weighing on our hearts, dear Lord, and we now bring to you the cares and concerns most important for each of us into this sacred time of prayerful silence. Mothering God, who offers living waters, receive these prayers and the prayers of our hearts in the name of the one who came to teach us how to pray together, Jesus Christ, our Lord, in his words, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. And our closing hymn is, Come, O Font of Every Blessing, Voices United 559.
Call for souls love, endless praise.
Friends, we are so glad you have chosen to worship with this community. I hope your time here has been a blessing to you, as your presence here has been a blessing to us. And as you leave this sacred place, may the creator of this watery globe, Jesus, the gift of God who gifts us with living water, and the Holy Spirit who lives everywhere and surrounds us all, go with you on your path today and every day. Amen.